لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة فكشف الله به الأمة فجزاه الله عنا خير ما جازى نبيا عن أمته وداعيا عن دعوته ثم أما بعد يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون ويقول سبحانه يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما ويقول سبحانه يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا اللهم اجعلنا من المتقين واجعلنا من الصالحين واجعلنا من الصادقين واجعلنا من الوارثين الذين يرثون الفردوس هم فيها خالدون اللهم آمين يا رب العالمين ثم أما بعد We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him as Allah should be praised. We thank Allah for His blessings that He bestowed upon us inwardly and outwardly. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His blessings, grace, bounties, favors that are in every corner of our lives and that are in every second of existence that we exist. Most of Allah's blessings upon us are in the hidden. We can see one or two or three. And even those who are apparent, we're kind of slow into recognizing them and thanking Allah Azza wa Jal for them. That's why when we sit between the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal, we have no complaints. If we have any complaints, the complaints that we have are about ourselves. Not from ourselves, but about ourselves. That we're most of the time busy. We hardly thank Allah enough. We hardly remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're grinded between the wheels of life, and we allow ourselves to go in this grinder knowingly, and we do not use the hands and the robe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He stretches to us to hold on so that we are pulled out of this ocean, deep ocean of dunya. SubhanAllah, brothers and sisters, that's the complaint of the believer. A believer does not focus on the negatives in his life. Oh, this is going wrong. Then you forget all the positives and you're only focused on this. And your dua is only for this and this. And usually that negative is usually something wrong going with us in dunya. It's usually not something going wrong with us with our deen or akhirah. When was the last time you lost sleep over missing your prayers? When was the last time you went into panic mode because you did not do your adhkar or tasbih? When was the last time you needed to see the psychologist and the psychiatrist because you have not been paying enough zakah and sadaqah? When was the last time that you went into depression because you feel that you don't have real connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Usually, It's because I got the news about my health, or I got the news about my wealth, or I got the news about someone that I love who wants to leave me or I want to leave. That's when people go into panic mode. None of these things are worthy of stopping your life and suspending your normal routine. None of these things. May Allah reward the Imam al-Hassan al-Basri, the Imam of Basra in Iraq. He said something very profound. Really shook me to the core. He said, if you haven't heard your name, oh Fulan, son of Fulan, you are from the people of hell, so go to hell. If you haven't heard that, you haven't heard bad news yet. What bad news are you talking about? What? Even if you've lost an arm, what bad news are you talking about? You haven't even heard your name called to hell. And if you haven't heard your name called to heaven, oh Fulan, son of Fulana, you are from the people of Jannah, so go to Jannah. You haven't heard good news yet. What good news are you talking about? You got a job? You made money? What? You got married? You have children? Any of these things can turn against you. Didn't Allah say, O you who believe, know that some of your children and some of your wealth are enemy to you. They will be the cause that you go to hell. Sometimes your own son turns against you and becomes your most vowed enemy. Sometimes your own wealth turns against you, and because of it, you end up with one heart attack after another, one stroke, and stress, and depression, and this, because of your own wealth. Your own wealth becomes your own enemy, as if there is someone who's just sitting down to bother you. That's the wealth you worked so hard to accomplish. That's why, brothers and sisters, this is a time of reflection. We are just beginning the new Hijri year. A beautiful year, a new year. And, you know, subhanAllah, you know, this whole Hijri year, the Sahaba had to meet and come up with a bid'ah, a good bid'ah, an innovation. What shall be year number one in Islam? The Muslims, what shall be year them? So some Sahaba said the birth of the Prophet. Some Sahaba said from the day the Prophet received the first revelation. Some Sahaba said from the death of the Prophet. Some Sahaba said from the Hijrah. And once that opinion of Hijrah was pronounced, all of them agreed upon. Because there became a need. Some people said, let's follow the Roman calendar. And Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab said, no, we shall have our own calendar. Their calendar is a solar calendar. Our calendar is a lunar calendar. And Allah told us in the Quran that the number of months in the sight of Allah are 12 months. The day in the book of Allah, the day He created the heavens and the earth, four of which are hurum, plural of haram, four of which are sacred months. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Allah decided that the number of months shall be 12 in the book of Allah, because Allah creates everything based on the record, the writings of the pen that Allah created and asked it to write, and write destinies and systems and physics and math and biology. All of this is written by the pen that Allah created and asked it to write the destinies of the world and the specifications of the world. So that in the book of Allah, the number of months are 12 months, of which four are sacred. The fact that Allah said, of which four are sacred, that means the 12 months that Allah is talking about in this ayah are lunar months, not solar months. Because there is no four sacred solar months. There's only 12 sacred lunar months. And people cannot appreciate lunar months today because they have a calendar on their iPhone. You click, you look what day. So you don't even have to click. You just turn on your iPhone. The date will pop into your face. But I'm going to ask you a question. If we take all the calendars, and if we take all the phones away from you, and all the roznamas and all of that, and I ask you, and you completely lose track of time, and I ask you to walk outside and tell me, are we in which month? And tell me exactly which day of the month, or approximately. You can walk all that you want, especially if you're in the Bay Area, the weather is good year-round, you wouldn't tell. But if I ask you, can you tell me where are we in the lunar month? All what you have to do is wait for the night to come and walk outside, and there is God's calendar in the sky, marked with a moon. The Arabs used to can tell the day exactly 13 or 14 or 15 just by looking at the moon. Even though for us right now, our eyes are not trained because we are not grown up with that. We can say maybe this is the middle of the month. They were able to tell exactly what day by looking at Allah's creation. And that's why the believer is connected with Allah's creation. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Even when you want to know the date, you have to look at Allah's creation. That's the significance of the lunar months. And as we can see, and we found out, even the nations that Allah sent before us, the Jews and the Christians, their calendars, the Prophet's calendars, were all lunar calendars. In Surah Al-Baqarah, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَهِلَّةِ هِيَ مَوَاقِيتُ لِلنَّاسِ وَالْحَجِ. They're asking you about the crescents, you know, the birth crescent, the end crescent, the middle, you know. So Allah says, they're asking you about the crescent, tell them it's for the timings of the people, and so that people can tell the timings of Hajj, and Ramadan, and all the other months. But in this ayah, Allah specified Al-Hajj, subhanAllah. So the Sahaba, radiallahu alayhim, had to face two tasks. Task number one, which year is going to be year number one? And task number two, which month shall be the first month? Because the Arabs did not go by, oh, Muharram means that's the first month of the year. No, they didn't go for that. So the Sahaba had to decide which month. And after so many opinions, they said, when people come to Hajj and they go home from Hajj and look at the spiritual meaning, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whosoever goes to Hajj and he performs good Hajj, MashaAllah, I'm very sure a lot of you here has just come back from Hajj. It is as if he came back to the day his mother gave birth to him or her. You hit the reset button when you go to Hajj. So the Sahaba said, whatever happens after that reset button should be number one. Month number one. Look at the understanding. Look at when you see everything through your imani lenses, you have this glasses of iman, and you even decide your first month of the year based on your spiritual values and iman, subhanAllah. So here we are in the month of Muharram, brothers and sisters. And I was thinking, what should I tell you? Because you probably hear so many khutbas about this. Beginning of the year, have tasks, have goals, write your goals, write this. All of this is good and amazing. And if you can get yourself to write something, that will be amazing, because that is also from the Quran, عَلَّمَ الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ. So writing something, writing your goals with a pen is amazing. But then you can write all the lists that you want and never follow up. So I think what we all need, before we get into the goals, what you want to achieve next year versus last year, because you are closer to death by 1 year right now, is to look deep inside your heart and ask yourself one question. What do I want? What do I want from this life? What do I want from me? What are my goals? Start with a big, big picture. And don't lie to yourself. Don't hide yourself from yourself. Because be careful, you are capable of doing that. Allah told us in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Successful is the one who purifies his nafs. Loser is he who hides himself. Ajib, the word دس الشيء يعني خبأه يعني hid it. Loser is he, the one who hides himself. يعني you hide yourself from yourself. You start lying to yourself so much that you can start saying, "Oh, there's nothing wrong with me. I am very good. MashaAllah, I pray 5 times a day. I have knowledge. I am this. I am that. Whatever is your mistake." And you start hiding your own faults. And maybe your whole family is telling you, "Please, Baba, we just need you to calm down a little bit. You have big time short temper." And you're like, "No, there is nothing wrong with me. No, I'm just very good." See, now we're getting into وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Okay. "Please, Mama, you're spending too much money. You know, Allah gave us money not to spend it. Allah gave us money so that we spend on our needs, and the extra money is not our money. We are only managers over it, we're not owners." People say, "Oh, our rizq is big." No, rizq is only your basic needs. There's a difference between income and rizq. Rizq is you eating, drinking, you know, shelter, car, these are the basic needs. But once you get into buying clothes every month and eating outside in the restaurants, this is not your rizq, this is someone else's rizq. Tell the difference between the two. We are at a place where we are encouraged, at a time and place where we are encouraged to become consumers. If you have money, you will never settle down. You can't go to sleep until you figure a way to spend that money. Just exactly like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He had an uqiyya of dhahab, an ounce of gold. So he lit Salat al-Asr, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaykum. Rasulullah usually sits down, makes dhikr after Salat. He got up and went to the door that goes to his rooms. He went to his hujurat, got something, walked outside. The sahaba are like, "This is not the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So by the time they were done doing their tasbih and their dua, the Prophet ﷺ came back and sat down and started doing their tasbih. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, you kind of worried us. They've never done this before." He said, No. "I remembered that I had an ounce of gold and I did not want the sun to set before I spent it fi sabilillah. So I went and gave it as sadaqa. Now I can come and do my tasbih comfortably." Are you like that? What do you want, brothers and sisters? What do you want? What are your goals? You are a believer. Allah has awakened you. You can't just go day by day. "Okay, let's go. Now we're going to go home and watch TV. Now we're going to watch this game. Now we're going to watch that." You can watch all of that so long as you have the big picture clear and you're doing something fi sabilillah. When you just go in dunya and you forgot about everything and you're just happy and everything is going normal, this is called in the Quran ghafla. Heedlessness. You are not aware, you're not awake, you're not alert, and believe me, when death is gonna hit you or a test is gonna hit you, it's gonna shake you up so much you're not gonna be in a good state. So how about you shake yourself before something else shakes you? So this is a coming year. You know yourself. Listen to the people around you who love you and give you advice. Listen to the voice of the believer inside you. Listen to the angel that Allah has dedicated to you to inspire you to do good things. Everyone talks about the shaitan, qareen, shaitan, qareen, which is true. We have a qareen that is shaitan and tries to whisper to you. But how many people talk that Allah dedicated for every human, an angel that inspires him to say, to do something good, say something good. And when the shaitan does waswasa, he does ilham, inspiration. Don't listen to the shaitan. It's your choice. You want to listen to the shaytan or you want to listen to the malak that is from Ar-Rahman? It's your choice. So brothers and sisters, start with deep inside your heart. What do you want? And from there, start tailoring a plan and goals. How am I going to reach to the goals? That's called a plan. Not dreams and wishes. لَيْسَ الْإِيمَانُ بِالتَّمَنِّي ولكن ما وقر في القلب وصدقه العمل. Faith is not by wishing, Faith is that which settled in your heart and is confirmed with your actions. So the lesson of the khutbah today, before we talk about the actions, what is it that has settled in your heart? What settled in your heart? What do you want from life? What do you want from yourself? What do you want from your spouse and children? What do you want from them? What do you want from your money? What do you want? What's the big picture here? And once you answer that question, then follow it with goals and plans, and then Allah will inspire you, inshallah. May Allah inspire us and keep the waswas of shaitan away from us. والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. اللهم يا مسبب الأسباب سبب لنا أسباب الخير يا رب العالمين. Brothers and sisters, you know, let's awaken. The entire ummah is waiting for its own individuals to wake up. The entire ummah is waiting for us, because the ummah is made of individuals. Your body is made of cells. One cell mutates and goes crazy, and the body doesn't know how to shut it down. It becomes cancer. And just so for your own information, every day we have cancer in our body. Every day there are cells that go crazy, and your immune system has a spy system that knows that, and it goes and kills it. Every day. So every day Allah is saving you. That's a blessing to remember. Brothers and sisters, let's look at this ummah as made of individuals, right? Let's learn. If you have that goal in your heart, then go and learn from the Book of Allah through the model of His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are not better than Rasulullah, nor you are better than Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu and the rest of Sahaba. Rasulullah was a calm personality. Work on your calmness. Use the dhikr, Quran, thinking, so that your mind is ahead of your emotions. Our homes are destroyed by anger. Divorce because of anger. Father, son, mother, daughter because of anger. Anger, 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 anger. What? Because you can't control your emotions. Your mind is not ahead of your emotions. Your emotions are ahead of your intellect. You have to stop. Your deen helps you to change that. So we need to start so that our families are preserved. So that not the smallest argument between husband and wife becomes a reason for divorce. Not the smallest argument between parents and children become a reason for kicking the child out or completely disengaging and not communicating. We need to start embodying these qualities from the deep iman to adab and akhlaq and morals and manners and good character. To knowing how to work together as an ummah, to supporting our masajid, to supporting our ummah. Subhanallah, from this minbar, every time a Muslim does an act of wrong, an act of violence, we stand up and we say, Allah and His Messenger, Islam is free from that. That's not Islam. Because it's one principle. Monks, Buddhist monks with their clothes, monk clothes on, are killing our brothers and sisters in Burma. When was the last time you heard Buddhist terrorism? On CNN or Fox News? We're talking about 500,000 people displaced, and God knows how many people left behind. And the government of Burma, in order for them not to have anything written so that they don't go to court later, they just entice the local temples and monks so that they can go do things that is not documented, unofficial, so that nobody will be caught later on. The easiest way to get out of judgment. Are all Buddhist terrorists? No. Are all Buddhists in Burmas and all Burmese terrorists? I'm sure not. But there's a heck of a lot of them that are staring violence against our brothers and sisters. Who's talking about that? Are you concerned? This is an ummah, one ummah. When you as an individual become a better individual, the whole ummah becomes healthy and good and working together. There's Burma Task Force. For the last 2 years, they've been sending emails. I received their email. Sign this. I signed this. Are you on the Burma Task Force? Are you filling applications so that the Congress and the Senate start an investigation? At least, if you can help with anything, a word, an action, a sadaqah. Had did your masjid last week? I stood up in my masjid and I said, all the boxes today, the donation will not go to our masjid. It will go to Burma. And we collected close to $10,000. And we give it to our brothers and sisters, ECHO, who have an organization here and an organization in Bangladesh. And it's already spent, the money's spent. Are you doing that as a community here? That's what makes you an active Muslim. And Allah will look at you and Allah will be pleased with you. Because from inside out, you're trying to change. Inshallah, Rabbil Alameen, Allah help us out. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma a'izza bina al-Islam wa nusrina al-Muslimin. Wa a'li bina kalimata al-haqqi wa al-deen. Wa ja'alna min ibadika al-salihin. Bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma wafir lil-Muslimin wal-Muslimat. Wal-Mu'minin wal-Mu'minat. Al-Ahya'i minhum wal-Amwat. Innaka qareebun sami'un mujibu al-da'awat. اللهم أعز بنا الإسلام وانصر بنا المسلمين وأعلي بنا كلمة الحق والدين اللهم اجعلنا صالحين مصلحين طاهرين متطهرين هادين مهديين اللهم لا تجعلنا لا من المنافقين ولا من المرائين ولا من الفاسدين ولا من الفاجرين ولا من الفاسقين ولا من الكافرين واجعلنا من عبادك الصالحين المتقين يا رب العالمين اللهم اغفر لإخواننا المسلمين وارحمهم في بورما يا رب العالمين اللهم ارحم إخوان المسلمين في سوريا يا رب العالمين اللهم ارحم إخوان المسلمين في ليبيا ومصر يا رب العالمين وارحم إخوان المسلمين في اليمن يا رب العالمين وارحم إخوان المسلمين في فلسطين يا رب العالمين اللهم ارحم إخوان المسلمين في أفغانستان يا رب العالمين وفي كشمير يا رب العالمين وفي كل مكان يا أكرم الأكرمين اللهم ارحم إخوان المسلمين في أفريقيا وفي الصين وفي كل مكان يا رب العالمين وعيننا على إعانتهم وكن لنا عونا لهم حتى نكون عونا لهم يا رب العالمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم آمين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما في السماوات والأرض